Welcome to worship with All Saints and Big Sky, a shared ministry of the Episcopal and ELCA Lutheran churches in Big Sky, Montana. Welcome to our online worship on this fifth Sunday after Epiphany. This morning, our order for worship is morning prayer from the Book of Common Prayer. I invite you to take a deep breath, a moment of quiet, and prepare to worship God. Send out your light and your truth that they may lead me, and bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia. God is the rock of our salvation. Come, let us worship.
To sing praises to our God. How pleasant it is to honor God with praise.
The Lord rebuilds Jerusalem and gathers the exiles of Israel.
The Lord heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds.
The Lord counts the number of the stars and calls them all by their names.
Great is our Lord and mighty in power. There is no limit to God's wisdom.
The Lord lifts up the lowly, but casts the wicked to the ground.
Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make music upon the harp to our God.
Who covers the heavens with clouds and prepares rain for the earth, making grass to grow up on the mountains.
God provides food for the cattle and for the young ravens when they cry.
God is not impressed by the might of a horse and has no pleasure in the speed of a runner,
but finds pleasure in those who fear the Lord, in those who await God's steadfast love. Hallelujah.
reading from Isaiah. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown. Scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power. Not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Blessed be the God of Israel, who comes to set us free and raises up new hope for us, a branch from David's tree. So then the prophets long declared that with a mighty arm God would turn back our enemies and all who wish us harm. With promised mercy will God still the covenant recall. The oath once sworn to Abraham from foes to save us all, that we without fear and offer lives of praise in holiness and righteousness to serve God all our days. My child, as prophet of the Lord, you will prepare the way to tell God's people that shine forth and never cease to drive away the gloom of death and lead us into peace.
A reading from 1 Corinthians. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not by my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What is then my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights of the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews I became a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has dawned upon you.
Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has dawned upon you. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has dawned upon you. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has dawned upon you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Jesus and his disciples left the synagogue at Capernaum and entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. Jesus came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases, and he cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. Sometimes the presence of the Holy One feels very close. You might be lying in bed like Simon Peter's mother-in-law. All tangled up in the sheets after a bad night of not so much sleep, you might feel heavy, weighed down 1,000 pounds. The fever dreams of the night haven't left your mind. Your heart is still racing. But then the presence of the Holy One comes close. The presence of Jesus, Jesus who answers to so many names in so many different languages, that presence comes close, close enough to lean down and take you by the hand. That touch, cool and solid on your hot and sweaty palm. And then this Holy One, this holy someone does more. He lifts you up. And there you are, finally standing upright. And your body feels like your own again for the first time in days or maybe months. Your head is clear, the pain is gone, and you realize you are capable and you are ready. You can do what needs to be done. And it feels so good to turn towards the needs of the people you love, of the world, to do your work, to do your part, to serve after all that feverish time in bed. Other times you are not so bad off in the beginning. Your body doesn't feel like it's been laid out for the wake while you're still alive. Other times you are able to move around, go through the day's tasks, even get them done, make your way around town along with everybody else. But still, you know this feeling? You are not entirely well. There is some brokenness lodged somewhere in you, throwing you off balance. And maybe it's a sickness with a very clear and concrete name, like heart disease or breast cancer or a sarcoma. Or maybe it's a brokenness that's harder to put into words, because grief for what is lost is like that. Grief breaks you up, it hollows you out, and it definitely strips you of words so that reality no longer feels real. But hopefully in those moments there is a community that is nearby, friends and family members, maybe even the neighbor whose name you can't remember, but they have such lovely eyes. Hopefully there is this community who lets you know, we know where you can go for help. Help is right there, just beyond that door. And perhaps it is that community that some way guides you, leads you in the right direction to that door. And there you are, all of you, gathered around the door. The whole town, the whole city, because after all, everyone needs help. Everyone is broken somewhere. And everyone now is waiting. Waiting but hopeful, waiting on the Lord, who will surely open that door in just a minute's time and renew everyone's strength. And there are other times too, early mornings while it is still dark, early mornings after two late nights, mornings when you long for God's comfort and strength and presence, but there is no community there yet to guide you to the door. And And so you find yourself wandering around, searching, hunting for that one, that holy one, that healer, the one about whom they say, have you not known? Have you not heard? The Holy One gives power to the faint, and you are faint because you are hunting. You are searching for that one. But you don't feel a presence. You only feel an absence. And all you can do is keep on searching, wondering when Jesus will finally come out of hiding, come away from wherever he is, that deserted place. When will Jesus finally come, show up, raise you up? Remember, like Simon Peter's mother-in-law. Our gospel reading this morning is just 11 verses. But in those 11 verses, our reading lays out three different postures in our life of faith. I'm sure we could come up with more, but these three cover a lot of territory. We might be stumbling around, searching desperately for a God who we cannot seem to find. Or we might be gathered with the community around the door, hopeful and waiting for Jesus to come out and start healing. Or, well, we might just be lying there. And it is Christ who comes to us and takes us by the hand and raises us up to do what needs to be done, to serve. I want to tell a story. Many years ago, when I was still a very new pastor and officially on maternity leave, one of my parishioners called me. And she told me what she could manage of the story, and immediately we got in the car. My spouse drove, and our infant was perched in those rear-facing seats because she would need to nurse before I would get back. And eventually, after many miles, we arrived at a little home in the woods where not so many hours earlier, in the very early morning, my parishioner's son-in-law had gone outside for the last time. Perhaps he was searching then, searching for the Holy One, the one that would heal him. But that early morning, at least in this life, he couldn't find that healing, and instead he died by suicide, and his wife, barely 25, heard the gunshot. I remember coming to the door. Her mother, my parishioner, was already there, and thankfully, a mentor of mine, an old, gnarled, retired pastor, came as well. And here is some wisdom I learned that day. If you can help it, don't go alone into tragedy. We need all the help we can get. And so we approached that door. Pastor Joe and I, we gathered around that door with prayer books in our hands, prayer books that are full of words that we hope say what can't be said in any other way. And we went inside. Eventually, my husband had to come inside too with our infant daughter. What a group we were in that trailer. This grief-stricken young widow who'd barely had any time to be married, and her mother in shock, and an old pastor who had walked through so many people's grief so many times, and me just figuring out what it meant to be a pastor and a mother, and my husband holding a baby who just wanted milk. And we all embraced each other and wept and took each other's hands. We, all of us there, were trying to serve one another as best we could. And sometimes we just sat quiet. And eventually, Pastor Joe and I prayed the prayers that usher grief into a house as gracefully as possible. But in those prayers, we also name the Holy One. The Holy One whose presence is so often hidden from our eyes, but is there in every place of grief. Because this is our faith, my sisters and brothers. The Holy One, the one that we call Jesus, finds a way into our broken houses and our broken hearts. Jesus, even though he is so often hidden from our eyes, finds a way to come close. Though we can wait sometimes for what feels like a long time, Christ comes close to strengthen us in our weakness and eventually to lift us up so that we can serve one another. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Shelter of the Lord, who abide in the shadow for life. Say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock, in whom I trust, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. The snare of the fowler will never catch. capture you, and famine will bring you no fear. Under God's wings, your refuge, with faithfulness, your shield, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. You need not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day. Though thousands fall about you, near you it shall not come. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. For to the angels God's given a command to guard you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. And hold you in the palm of his hand.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Save your people, Lord, and bless your inheritance.
Govern and uphold them now and always.
Day by day, we bless you.
We praise your name forever.
Lord, keep us from all sin today.
Have mercy upon us, Lord. Have mercy.
Lord, show us your love and mercy.
For we put our trust in you.
In you, Lord, is our hope. And we shall never hope in vain. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, in you we live and move and have our being. We humbly pray to you to guide and govern us by your Holy Spirit, that in all the cares and occupations of our life, we may not forget you, but we may remember that we are ever walking in your sight. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, you stretched out your arms of love on the hard wood of the cross that everyone might come within the reach of your saving embrace. So, clothe us in your Spirit that we, reaching forth our hands in love, may bring those who do not know you to the knowledge and love of you for the honor of your name. Amen. Amen.
Christ the healer, I have come to pray for help, to plead for friends. How can we fail to be restored when reached by love that never ends? From every flesh endures, our bodies clamor to be freed, yet in our hearts we would confess that wholeness is our deepest need. In conflicts that destroy our health, we recognize the world's disease. Our common life declares our ills. Is there no cure, O Christ, for these? Grant that we all made one in faith in your community may find the wholeness that enriching us shall reach the whole of humankind.
We pray for the church's many ministries of healing, for hospital, hospice, and military chaplains, and for those serving in prisons and camps. We pray for the health of the earth, for its many animals and their habitats. We pray for the health of people around the globe, especially for the people of Ethiopia and India, for international health organizations, and for our local Bozeman Health and Big Sky Medical Center. We pray for wholeness in our nation, for an end of domestic violence, and for an end to racial injustice. We pray for a halt to the pandemic, for health workers, and for the prompt distribution of vaccines, and for those who will die today of the virus. We pray for all who are sick and suffering, for those with chronic pain, for those experiencing despair, for babies born with medical issues, and for those whose bodies are in decline. pray for the health of marriages and families, and we ask your blessing on new marriages. Especially this week, we pray for Aaron and Mike as they make their vows to each other. We pray finally for ourselves and for health in our weaknesses. And we also pray for Robbie, each member of the Bevan family, John, Liz, Mike, Sandy, Mike, Patricia, Bob, Andrea, Bill, Carol, Michael, baby Wesley, Maudie, Dorothea, Brian, Keith, Jess, Rob, Melissa, Brittany and the Marvin Hilton family, Stuart, the Peterson Frankel family, Stephanie, Christopher, Stan, Maximilian, Daniela, Isabella, Acra, Emery, Lauren, Danica, Audrey, baby Walden, and Jill. We praise you for the faithful departed and for their lives of service to others. And we pray that despite sickness and health, at our end, we join with them to find our wholeness in you. Let us now pray the general thanksgiving together. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all the ages. Amen.
Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation in the church and in Christ Jesus forever and ever. Amen. Amen. And as we go forth from our homes and into our weeks, the peace of Christ be with you always.